is Rachel and I'm a crofter here on Fair Isle, the UK's most remote inhabited island. I'm really excited today to be able to welcome you to the Fair Isle's George Waterston Memorial Centre, also known as our museum. And over the next few episodes, I hope to show you around and introduce you to the exhibits that we have here and hopefully teach you a bit more about Fair Isle. So I thought I'd start off by giving you a sort of a quick walkthrough of the museum, and then we'll look at the different sections in turn. So when you first come into the museum, you're into what we call the Croft House kitchen, as it were, which is set up as an original Croft House kitchen may have looked. Then we have exhibits on agriculture in the aisle. On shipwrecks, as you can imagine, there have been quite a lot over the centuries. The lighthouse service. Boat building and fishing. And knitwear. We'll look a bit more at Fair Isle strawback chairs in this coming episode. But first of all, I have a couple of thanks on behalf of the museum that I would like to say. Firstly, a massive thanks to Bob Worrell of Traditional Fair Isle Crafts, who for the last couple of years has been Stuart Thompson's sort of apprentice, learning how to make the strawback chairs. And he has donated very kindly this beautiful example to our collection here at the museum. This was much earlier in the year and we had been hoping to have a big kind of get together party celebration by way of thanks, but unfortunately with COVID that's not been possible. So I've been asked by the other members of the museum staff to publicly say a very, very big thank you to Bob for the hours and hours that he put into making this beautiful chair and for so kindly donating it to our museum collection. The second thanks that I have to give is you may be familiar with Anne Sinclair's fantastic Fair Isle Fisherman's Kept pattern, which can be bought via the Facebook page of the same name, Fair Isle Fisherman's Kep. And all the monies raised from the sales of that pattern have gone to the museum and to get new windows installed. I believe these were installed, gosh, was it last year, the year before? So lost with the time at the moment. But they have made such a massive difference to the museum, and that's all thanks to the people that bought the Fair Isle Fisherman's Kept pattern. So thank you so much to all of you who not only bought the pattern but became part of the the group on Facebook, which is a really, really thriving group, really nice community. It's solely dedicated to the Kett pattern. So there are other pages about ferrule knitting in general, but if you're interested, please do check it out. Some really great information and beautiful examples of Kett's there. I thought I'd tell you a little bit about the building itself before we go and look at the exhibits in more detail. So what we are standing in now, the museum, was originally the Isle Schoolhouse. Following that, once a new school was built, it became the Isle's Hall. So lots of gatherings, celebrations, dances, wedding feasts were held here over the years. And then in 1980, the building fell into disuse as the new hall was built and opened. And then following a really successful campaign of hard work by Anne Sinclair and her family, who managed to get funding and secure all the applications, the planning permissions and everything that goes with it, the building eventually became what we know it today, the George Waterston Memorial Centre and Museum. If you're not familiar with the name George Waterston, he was an ornithologist who in the Second World War was taken as a prisoner of war, and he kept dreaming of Fair Isle and coming back to Fair Isle one day, and that's kind of what kept him going. And following the end of World War II, in I think it was 1947 or 1948, the opportunity to buy Fair Isle came up. And George Waterston was successful in his bid to buy it. And really it's all thanks to him that we have a current sort of bird observatory staff here on the Isle and the great work they do, because he established the first bird observatory here, which was originally in huts that were left by the Royal Navy at the end of the Second World War. So very different from the accommodation that you may have been familiar with over the last few years, and hopefully in the next years to come. So he was a really, really big part of Isle life. He did a lot for the island, really, I guess, kind of tourism. Certainly bird tourism is down to him, thanks to him. So we owe, as an island, as residents, even now, we owe him a huge debt of gratitude, and that's why the museum is named the George Waterston Memorial Centre. As I've said, this first exhibit is set up somewhat as a Croft house may have looked in years gone by, probably up to around about the 1960s, as it was only in the 1960s that running water and electricity first came to Fair Isle. Before then, they would have drawn water from wells, and lighting would have been provided by tilly lamps, such as this one up here. They used paraffin, and apparently they had to be sort of pumped every hour to keep the pressure on. Another form of lighting was called a collie lamp, and this is an example here, and that would have used fish liver oil, so could have been quite stinky. Talking about electricity on the Isle, when they first got electricity, they had 3 7-kilowatt generators, and each house was allowed a maximum consumption of 1 kilowatt. The electricity, the generators were switched on for 1 hour on a Monday morning, and that allowed the wives to get their washing machines on and get their week's washing done. And then other than that, it was on every evening from sunset to 10 p.m. This door here, you can see with the white porcelain handle, originally came off the Black Watch, which was a ship built in Nova Scotia, who was on her maiden voyage from Bremen to New York in 1877. So everything on board was in excellent condition. Unfortunately, she was caught in the rip of a tide and driven into Shalstane, which is in the southwest of the Isle. All the crew and the passengers were saved though, but obviously lots of things such as wood, doors, hinges, anything that could be salvaged really was brought ashore by the residents and the crew. So this door here was originally in use as an internal door at Springfield, which is one of the houses on the Isle. And it's where Anne Sinclair's family used to live. And she and her brothers, Neil and Stuart, remember that as children, they would always get told off for slamming the door because their parents didn't want the doorknob, which is porcelain, to break. This little stool here is called a creepy. They're common all over the UK, I believe, and have various local names for them, but here on Fair Isle and possibly in Shetland too, I'm not sure, they're called creepy. And it has a hole here, the idea being you can pick it up and carry it. And this would have been used as a milking stool, so you could carry your creepy stool in one hand and then the pail for the milk in the other. And there's a Fair Isle knitting pattern which is called the creepy legs pattern, and that's said to derive from the shape of a creepy. You'll find that certain things that were made of wood end in the word tree. So this item here, it's not for doing injury to people, it's for mashing potatoes. And this is called a chapin tree. And another example is this quite simple looking tool, which you may know as a spurtle for stirring porridge. And here apparently it's known as a gruel tree. So another example of the tree ending. This is what's called a lazy cate, and that's used for plying wool or yarn. The spinning wheel here, I believe came from Utra, down in the south of the island. Apparently, though, when it was found, it had such a bad case of woodworm that about two thirds of it was replaced by Stuart Thompson Sr., who until very, very recently made spinning wheels here on the island. A couple of guns up here. The bottom one, I believe, was a 12 bore, and that would have been used for hunting duck, geese, woodcock, and so on. The top one is apparently one of two that came from the army. It was originally a Mauser action rifle from the Boer War, but was converted to a shotgun. And I was told that it used to be called the trombone due to its long barrel. Stuart's Uncle Jimmy owned it and decided it was no longer functional, decided to get rid of it by destroying it. Obviously this is quite a long time ago. So in deciding to get rid of it, his method of destruction was he stuck it into the ground as far as it would go, laid a charge to it, which he detonated remotely, and the result was apparently the rifle blew about 20 foot into the air, left a big crater in the ground, and there wasn't a scratch on the rifle. This fiddle or violin here was made by Thomas Yunson. He was an islander who went to sea. And then when he came back to Fair Isle, he built a boat out of wood, which nothing unusual about that. But what was unusual was that he built the engine out of wood and apparently used to turn a handle to propel the boat. When he left Fair Isle, he then went to Dunrossness, which is part of Shetland, where he built Sixerenes, which are a type of boat we'll look at in a future episode. This item here, I've written down phonetically in my notes that it's made that it's called a scurribrid. You'll have to excuse my pronunciation. I don't know if that's correct or just how I've heard it. And apparently it was used for sharpening knives. So you would keep something which I've written down as bath brick, but I've got a question mark against it, in the little pot there. And you would take it off your wall, lay it down flat, dampen your knife with water, then roll it in this crushed bath brick or whatever it is, and then you would sharpen your knife against the grooves in the wood. This barometer here was from the Shipwrecked Fishermen and Mariners Society. You can just see on the side here, it had a slot where people could make donations, and the donations went to the wives and children of men that had been lost at sea. And apparently this used to be in place at Melville House, which is now known as Utre. These funny looking objects here are called leam pigs. Leam is the word for china. And they are hot water bottles. These big enamel bowls here would have been used for separating the cream from the milk. You had your pail, which you would use in one hand, your creepy in the other, you'd take that and milk your cow, and then come back and pour the milk into these bowls. And these ones apparently were used by Anne and Stuart and Neil's Auntie Aggie. And Anne has told me that she can remember her aunts blowing the cream sort of from the top of the bowl, and then in one sort of swift movement pouring it's straight into a bottle without spilling a drop, which must have been some skill, as even I can't pour from a jug without spilling stuff. The bell here, you can just see on there, it says SS Strathbeg 1906 Aberdeen. This was off a trawler, almost a brand new trawler, which wrecked here. She found it on the Fless, which is a big kind of rock just offshore, in 1907, so she was barely a year old. The crew managed to get into the lifeboat, but it was thick fog, and so when later on islanders saw this deserted ship, they thought, oh wow, our luck's in, we can salvage what we can off here. And it was only once the fog lifted that they spotted the lifeboat as well. In the early 1900s, there was a lot of bad feeling between trawler men and islanders, as the islanders believed that lots of trawler men would come inside the zone that they weren't meant to fish inside, And there are tales of them going out in their yoles up to the trawlers and sort of pelting them with rocks and other things. So when the islanders put to sea in their yoles to try and help these men in the lifeboat, you can imagine that the men in the lifeboat weren't too sure what their intentions were. However, they persuaded the men in the lifeboat to come back ashore where they were looked after very well. And for many, many years, the skipper of the trawler did whatever he could to help the people on Fair Isle, bringing them goods, transporting people or goods if they needed it. The Bell, I believe, was brought up in the 1970s from a dive, and it's hung here in the museum now. Items such as chairs, dressers, tables and so on were made locally, but as you may know, Fair Isle doesn't have any trees, so they would have to rely on shipwrecks and salvage for wood to build things. In 1915, a ship called the Canadia was run onto Haley Stack. However, all the crew were saved. She was carrying a cargo of flour, cotton and walnut. The cotton was needed by the government for armament. If you can imagine, we're just in the early years of the First World War. And the walnut was needed for barrel stock for rifles heading for Germany. Apparently the Fair Isle residents were given cotton and flour as a sort of payment for their help. Wood off shipwrecks was also used to build houses. I've been told that the main mast of ships was used as the main beam in some houses here. You may have seen these kind of straw back chairs before. These ones are Fair Isle straw back chairs, but there's also a variation, the Orkney straw back chairs. There's some subtle differences in that the Fair Isle straw back chairs used oat straw and cotton, whereas the Orkney chairs used sisal. The Orkney chairs, however, were the first ones to be produced commercially. Apparently in Orkney, if the chairs have a hood, that would be a woman's chair, and if it had no hood, that would be a man's chair. But that wasn't something that was ever adopted here on Fair Isle. Also, these drawers that you can see in the bottom of the chairs, that design feature originated here in Fair Isle, but was soon picked up by Orkney makers as well. Also, the Fair Isle chairs have slightly curved sides. This chair here, this sort of hardback chair, I believe is called a lambing chair. And you get them again all throughout the UK. And this here is a postcard of a chair that was made by Stuart Thompson Jr. And this was one that was built for the Millennial Exhibition of Indigenous Crafts in Scottish Museums. And after it had served its time on display in Scotland, it then went to North Carolina in America and to the Smithsonian Museum in Washington, along with a boat from Fair Isle, built by Ian Best. So that was our first look here at the museum here on Fair Isle. I really hope you enjoyed that. I must say, I've only done 1 year so far as a volunteer here at the museum. So any mistakes are all mine. People have been very, very kind in telling me their stories, which I've kind of scribbled down as best I can to help me remember them. But any mistakes, as I say, are in my poor remembering of what I've been told. So I hope you'll forgive me. Next time we'll have a look here at the section on agriculture. So I hope you'll join me in the next episode.